like to welcome you, in particular the Honorable Consul General from Greece, and all our distinguished guests, and our students, and those of you who have come particularly to hear the delivery this afternoon. This series of lectures, which we started in January, is what we see as part of the mission of Fairleigh Dickinson University. The university was established in 1942 when we had a war raging, a very big war in the world. And in particular, the founder of the university wanted to establish a learning place where people from across the world could come together and talk through their problems rather than mount heavy weapons, fly them around, and shoot at each other. And it had been his hope that this university would give leadership in regard to that kind of world. For the last 70 years, Fairleigh Dickinson University has concentrated on being a university that's interested in the world. So long before globalization became a popular word, globalization was the very basis of this university. And from the beginning, the university aligned itself very closely to the United Nations. And so we have many programs that are connected to the United Nations. We have four campuses around the world, two in New Jersey, where we have our headquarters, one in outside Oxford, England, and the newest one, the one here in Vancouver, which has been around for the last 4 years and is continuing to grow and developing new programs. What we are attempting to do with this series of lectures is to invite representatives from countries around the world. We have no less than 31 countries represented among our student body. So we invite representatives from various countries in the world to talk about their own countries, about the political situation and the education issues that they have in their countries. And there are, of course, many hot topics today in many of the countries. Among these, clearly, is the situation in the EU, and in particular the debt crisis that we have among certain EU countries. We are fortunate this afternoon to have among us a distinguished representative from Greece who is the Consul General here in Vancouver. Georgios Iafantis is a career diplomat with the Hellenic Ministry of Foreign Affairs. He joined the HMFA in 1985 after he studied law, history, and political sciences in both Athens and Paris. In the HMFA, he has dealt with issues related to NATO, the Middle East, the Balkans, and with human rights issues. He has been posted abroad to Bucharest in Romania, to the Council of Europe in Strasbourg, France, and to Ottawa, Canada. On July 14, 2006, while serving as Deputy Director in the Middle East Division of the HMFA, he was dispatched to the Greek Embassy in Beirut as Chargé d'Affaires, and he stayed there throughout the war between Israel and Lebanon. Since November 2008, he has served as Consul General of Greece here in Vancouver. So clearly from that background, the Consul General has vast experience, has a lot to tell us about the world at large, but in particular, as his interest is in his own country, we are looking forward this afternoon to hearing him speak about Greece and the crisis in Europe, largely around the financial crisis. So please join me in welcoming the Consul General of Greece.
Thank you very much. Thank you for coming. Thank you for your time. kind words. I will use the podium if you don't mind. Well, I'll try not to repeat what I've said in the lecture last month about the Greek debt problem. I'll try to focus on the larger framework, which is the EU. And of course, I'll take any questions about Greece. Anyway, the two issues are interrelated. Also, I'll try my best to clarify that I am speaking in my personal capacity. I'm not speaking on behalf of the Greek government. So, of course, I'll point out what eventual position the Greek government has on this issue. And if you ask me, I would be more than glad to repeat it. But I'm talking on a personal, in my personal capacity, so I do not represent these comments I make, represent just me. So, let me start from a few key questions about the debt crisis, and then we will try to check the way forward. First key question is, at what extent the sovereign debt is a threat to the existence of euro? Will the euro survive if Greece or Ireland, or both, default on the sovereign debt? Question number two or three, if you wish. Will the euro be sustainable as the common currency for only certain of the countries actually participating to it, namely as the common currency for Germany, France, the Netherlands, Finland, and Austria? Broadly on these same questions, the World Service of BBC surveyed 38 European economists on March 28th. 25 out of the 38 forecasted a default in the Eurozone, and all 25 pointed Greece as the place it will happen. Out of the 25, 14 added Ireland as an equally unavoidable naufrage. Still, 34 out of the 38 foresee that Europe will survive and that the Eurozone will not break up. Now, once the bets are led, please allow me a closer look to these key questions. Sovereign debts are potentially a deadly threat for the value of any currency. And why on earth euro would be an exception to that? Greece represents the 2% of the Eurozone's total GDP. An eventual default of the Greek state over its sovereign debt, could it bring the whole thing down? Well, we have 34 economists saying no. And this is perhaps a cheating sign if, along with George Soros, we admit that in economics, the unthinkable happens surprisingly often. Soros' phrase goes on, saying, bet big on that, and you'll usually make money. Let's return to the calculations of the mainstream economists. They argue that banks in the core of the Eurozone can withstand a hit from one, two, or even three small peripheral defaults. Their eventual losses on Greek bonds, Irish bonds, or even Portuguese bonds are sustainable. In a worst-case scenario, they argue that the European Central Bank, instead of supporting failing economies on the periphery of Europe, governments in the periphery of Europe, should better focus its support on the mainly French and German banks, which will be affected from the failed bonds. Of course, this may drive some nations of the periphery to abandon the euro. To the mainstream school of thought, such a development is not going to be the end of the world as we know it. They support that the euro will soar up once it will be relieved from the burden of the dropouts, that is the burden of the of their insolvent debts. On the other hand, they argue that by reverting to national and heavily devaluated currencies, the dropouts themselves, the countries that will drop out of the euro, will have plenty of chances, not to mention time, to develop competitive exports and to gradually fix their ailing economies. Now, the much advertised economic sanity of such a scenario, which is immensely popular among analysts of rating agencies and academics, tantamount to its political insanity. Give a moment's notice to the German finance minister, Wolfgang Schäuble. The common European currency is mainly in Germany's interest, Schäuble told reporters in Brussels on March 11th. The failure of the European currency and the exit of one member would be a failure with incalculable repercussions for Germany, on Germany. What stands behind Mr. Schäuble's prudence is the instinctive knowledge that economies are by excellence social and political procedures. Beyond the markets, there are societies, people who hope, trust, fear and panic, vote, and eventually revolt. The political repercussions of having one, not to mention the possibility of two, European economies defaulting over their sovereign debt are an unpredictable factor in the pure economic equation where analysts only see investors, bondholders and markets. A dropout will make the euro crumble because most probably the European Union itself will crumble since the default and the subsequent exit of just one member from the eurozone will be perceived as a major breach of a decades-long political and economic investment of trust and solidarity, and precisely this is the cornerstone of the European Union. Let us go back to George Soros and allow me to quote him again from a lecture he gave to Hamburg University in Germany on June 23rd last year. This is George Soros speaking. He says, the euro is in crisis and Germany is the main protagonist. Unfortunately, Germany does not realize what it's doing. All it wants is to maintain its competitiveness and avoid becoming the deep pocket to the rest of Europe. By insisting on pro-cyclical policies, Germany is endangering the European Union. This is a grave accusation, but it is justified. Germany cannot be blamed for wanting a strong currency and a balanced budget, but it can be blamed for imposing its predilection on other countries that have different needs. The deflationary policies imposed on the Eurozone go against everything learned from the Great Depression of the 30s. They could well push Europe into a prolonged stagnation or into an outright depression, creating the risk of strikes, political turmoil, and social unrest. In a worst-case scenario, the EU could be paralyzed or destroyed by the rise of xenophobic and nationalist extremists. And Soros went on with a description of the bleak perspective of the euro breakup, supposing quite interestingly that it is Germany who reverts among the first to the Deutschmark, quitting the euro. He says, the restored Deutschmark will soar, the euro would plummet, the rest of Europe would become competitive and grow its way out of difficulties. But Germany would find out how painful it can be to have an overvalued currency. Its trade balance would turn negative and there would be widespread unemployment. Banks would suffer severe losses on exchange rates and will require large injection of public funds. The German government will find it politically acceptable to rescue German banks, more acceptable than it was to rescue Greece or Spain some years before. An And there would be other compensations as well, compensations. German pensioners would retire to Spain and live like kings, helping Spanish real estate to recover. So this is the projection that George Soros is doing. And the worrying thing with Soros is that although he sounds like the mythical Cassandra many times, he had made big money out of the materialization of his bad omens. So the question is whether he will be right this time. And the best way to verify is to look more closely to the recent decisions taken by the European leaders on the issue of sovereign debt. On March 11th and March 25th, the EU leaders held two summit-level meetings. Their objective was precisely to incorporate to the European Union treaties a mechanism that would prevent excessive deficits and debts, as well as to provide the EU treaties with a post-therapy treatment for Greece and Ireland, which are currently bailed out by an ad hoc mechanism called the European Financial Stability Facility. So the leaders came up with a blueprint of two complementary treaties, which are to be finalized on the customary EU summit of June. The first, which is to be called the Pact for Euro, will enforce, starting from January 2012, a number of principles that will heal and prevent, as we hope, macroeconomic deficiencies in the Eurozone member states. Under penalty of sanctions that might reach up to 0.2 of the gross of the GDP, the Eurozone members are to curb the sovereign debt to just 60% of the GDP. This shall be achieved starting 2015, that is in 3 years' time, at an annual rate of 5%. Constitutional amendments have to be passed and set 60% of GDP as the maximum of sovereign debt allowed in the Eurozone. Equally draconian measures are to be applied on budget deficits through strict austerity on wages and pensions. On the other hand, competitiveness of each national economy will be a condition for the Eurozone membership. So far, information on these two treaties is quite nebulous. Still, the question of the issue of competitiveness begs two questions. Question number one, are the Eurozone economies bound to be competitive in comparison with whom? To whom? China, the United States, Germany? Question number two, how do we measure overall competitiveness? It's a big issue. I would be glad to take it, to reply questions on that. Now, the second treaty agreed upon in Brussels bears the name of European Stability Mechanism. It will start not before mid-2013, that is in 2 years' time, and it is to provide any Eurozone economy in distress with the adequate and affordable credit denied by the markets. To that end, 440 billion euros were earmarked, out of which Germany is to provide 27%, roughly, in forms of guarantees and injections of capital. The precise mix of the two and the timing have yet to be spelled out. Still equally important, but still vague, is the procedure under which the new mechanism will kick in and support an ailing economy, that is, whether it is going to intervene after 17 or less national approvals, because the Euro has 17 members, as well as the extent of the support. That is, are they going to support an ailing economy before or after an eventual haircut of its debt? These uncertainties that surround critical details of the new mechanism, plus the fact that they are designed to address future problems and not the current burning ones, put in doubt not only the efficiency of the Euro's armor, but the intentions of the leading European nations as well. Greece and Ireland were rescued from immediate insolvency through packages of 110 and 8 billion respectively. Yet, the maturity of these loans comes only in 7 years, and the rate of interest applied, which is 4.5%, exceeds by 3% the cost at which Germany is raising in the markets the capitals that then are lent to the Greeks and to the Irish. So it's nothing of a gravity, while at the end of the 3-year rescue treatment, the debt for Greece will modest, sovereign debt, will modestly peak at 160% of its GDP. It was 127 when the rescue started. For Ireland, it will end up being 125% of GDP. Now, the access of these two countries to the future stability mechanism will be conditioned by an evaluation of their possibility, of their capacity to pay that debt at that time. So, until then, that is, in order to help these two nations navigate the next 2 years, both countries are asked by the European Union leaders to be stripped of either of the public assets, including land, and this is the case for Greece, or of the low corporate tax of 12.5, which has been the major competitive advantage of the Irish economy over the last 2 decades. Conclusion, my conclusion, is that both economies are deprived from any tangible means of growth. Therefore, even if they slash the budget deficits, take all the pain of necessary structural reforms of their economy and slash the annual budget deficits, they will not persuade markets to ask for anything less than 10% in order to buy Greek or Irish bonds. Moreover, European leaders will not hear of debt reduction now, but insist that any country requiring help from 2013 and onward may have to suffer a debt restructure, and that the new official lending will take priority over current bondholders. In such a perspective, the rescue plan currently implemented will be soon perceived by the Greek and Irish people and by the respective governments as well, those in charge now or new ones, as nothing more than a squeezing out of their wealth and of their future. With both nations sharing a tradition of violent and defiant revolts, the greedy European bankers and the incompetent European politicians risk to lose much more than what they anticipate. This is the end of my intervention, and I will be glad to take questions. We have also two graphics. I would be glad to explain why the second one. First one regarding the Greek and Irish yields, Greek and Irish bonds, things of this. Just to give you an idea how much you risk to earn if you buy Greek or Irish bonds right now. The second one I would be glad to.
Good afternoon. I've enjoyed your presentation very much. I'm from the United States, so we have a little vested interest in what's going on in Europe from many perspectives. I have a question, though, to you. In your opinion, how likely and what would be the consequences if the dominoes fall not just with Portugal, which appears to be pretty certain based upon what I've just been reading in various financial newspapers, but what if Spain takes the same course as Greece and Ireland? Do you think that's likely, number one? And number two, what do you see the consequences to what you're predicting?
Well, Let's first start with Spain. Why should Spain default of its sovereign debt? Simply because Greece, Ireland, and eventually Portugal have suffered similar fate. And simply because the European Union has not persuaded markets that they are there to defend effectively the weaker economies. Now, these weaker economies did not default by themselves. I mean, if we had just one case, as it was the case for Greece for a year, it was supposed to be because the Greeks are, you know, fans of the sun and the sea, and they are waiting for the North European women to come there and take advantage of it. They do not work, they don't pay taxes. I mean, I've heard all the spectrum. I mean, we are sweet-looking monsters. But what about the Irish? I mean, you cannot blame everything on IRA. What about Portugal? I mean, they are normal guys, they're quiet guys. Not quite Mediterranean. So there should be a problem. The problem is that the surplus of the North is practically the deficit of the South. There's something working badly in this European Union. I mean, it's natural. It's natural. If you put Ontario next to the North territories and ask them to compete from an economic point of view, I don't think that Northern territories would make it. So the logical conclusion is that if the European Union wants to prevent markets from attacking Spain, people like George Soros, Paulson, try to make money out of an eventual Spanish default, there are ways. There are ways to provide them with cheap money. And cheap money is only available through a Eurobond. Practically what so far the European leaders refused to do is that Germany and France will put down their economy, and they will borrow the necessary money. They will obtain the loans as Eurozone. They will issue Eurobonds, and then they will distribute it to each economy that has problems, setting the necessary conditions to the recipients, to the end recipients. If we leave Portuguese, Greek, Irish, to Mauritanians, to fight along with the markets have the upper hand. Simply because this is how markets work. So Spain, yes, indeed, there is a real estate problem there, overvalued real estate. There is a huge private debt. It's not sovereign debt. But at the end, the banks will be rescued by the Spanish government. So practically, we speak about sovereign debt, though this Spanish state is not in debt itself, but the Spanish households are in debt. This is the only way to prevent it. Now, if by any chance, because I mean, study the European Union and see that, and you will see that European leaders were not exactly guys with a huge perspicacity. If by any chance one member state, Greece, most probably Ireland, will default over its sovereign debt, then, first of all, a number of people that are that have insurance bonds on a Greek debt, on a Greek default, will earn a lot of money, Mr. Soros, Mr. Paulson, etc. The so-called CDS, which is an insurance over Greek or Irish or Portuguese default. Secondly, the political repercussions will be beyond the control of the weak European governments. All major European governments are quite weak. Take Italy, take Germany, politically weak. Their coalitions, loose coalitions, their elections ahead in France, etc., etc. So if somebody leaves the room, then the real economy will suffer, not from because 2% is huge, though if you check the second graph, you will see that there are vested interests in some particular kinds of investments and sales. But the political repercussions. I mean, the whole thing risks to come down simply because it's not a very solid edifice. It is. I mean, I cannot imagine people like Soros or Paulson attacking the United States economy because California had a default in the sovereign debt a few years ago.
And how is the this crisis going to affect the European Union as an integration of countries? Because it's very difficult to separate the interest of a country compared to the interest of the whole conglomerate of countries.
Well, the crisis, once it started with Lehman Brothers' collapse, affected very negatively all thoughts for European integration. Because integration is built on welfare. I mean, on societies that are doing, on economies that are doing well. If this storm on the horizon, people by instinct stick with their national borders, the national government, they do not trust supranational political frameworks. And they're right, because the European Union is not just a common market. The ambition is there for a federation and for a common foreign policy, common economic policy. And this is put under an enormous stress, right? So I do not predict the end of the European Union. Far from that, there is a very political capital to the European solidarity, the European Union. But I mean, they have to. The proof of the pudding is in the eating. They have to make it through. If they do not make it through, they didn't deserve.
Back in 2009, some politicians in France and Britain encouraged economic nationalism. So basically, they encouraged that putting taxpayer money back into the economy and encouraged local banks to lend at home. Do you think that Greece will take that approach or encourage more international trade?
Well, I mean, you are talking about two very different economies, the French economy and the Greek economy. The Greek economy has no other path than austerity. The issue is whether this austerity and this crisis will put them through the jungle and back to civilization, or they'll stay and rot inside the jungle. You cannot stimulate the Greek economy with more money, because for years and years the Greek political elite was stimulating the economy with money that they were not theirs. They were just borrowing money using them in a very unequal way. Also, the problem with Greece is also that if you check the second graphic, you'll see that we were one of the best customers of German, French industries, and that was not that was done with money that the German and French banks lent to Greece at a very high rate. So we were borrowing money to buy non-tradable goods. Instead of fixing our economy, we were making delivery games, we were buying arms and equipment. So no more injections are possible. In France, I don't want to speak for my French colleague, is not here today, but it's an entirely different story. It's another society, it's another economy. It's an economy with exports. And perhaps there, the classic recipe of by Maynard Keynes might work. But in the Greek economy, the need of growth goes hand in hand with the need to control the deficit and to cut one way or another the debt, simply because if you restructure it, you will be kicked out of the markets and you will have a spillover effect over other weak chains of the European Union. So it's a very delicate, thin line we have to walk over it. We cannot default, we cannot go back to our currency. It will be catastrophic, first of all, for the Greek economy. One third of the Greek debt is in the Greek hands. But at the same time, we would open a hole in the European boat. So we have to endure a very delicate and difficult task. France is in another planet.
It's often said that we are where we are in Greece and we are in Ireland and in Portugal because of the behavior of the people in each of those countries, that there are programs in place, social and welfare programs, that are far beyond what they can afford. And so other Europeans see themselves as having to support these countries, particularly Germany. And worry that if these countries are benefiting, that people are benefiting from a whole lot of programs which they can't afford. How do you react to that?
Well, the welfare state, if you compare what Greek pensions are, or German pensions are, British pensions are, Greece is living on four levels. So it's not true. It's not true that German taxpayers paying for the pension, the Greek pension, for high Greek pension. It doesn't make sense, it does not respond to the reality on the ground. What would be necessary is, of course, I mean, why do people join the European, the Eurozone? They adopt the common currency in their home, not to make life easier for accountants all over Europe, but in the hope that their standard of life will reach the German and French standard of life, the highest, or the Luxembourg standard of life. So they do, people are convinced precisely for that. It's not true that once Greece entered the Eurozone, suddenly the pensions were doubled, etc., etc. There are structural problems within the Greek economy, and there's political clientelism, and the political elite has to bribe the people with not pensions worth of the world, but with just little tips. And these tips are underlined and they are investigated and they are criticized by the world media, and this is correct. But take these tips out and try to live on a Greek pension. It's really impossible, even in Greece. To allow you a comparison, prices in Greece are higher than you can in food, etc. In elementary, to cover your elementary needs. Services are cheaper. So, this is an internal contradiction of the European Union. They have to accommodate societies with different needs and economies that are working on a different pace. There's no infrastructure in Greece. And this is why I said, what does competitiveness mean? I mean, if Greece adopts Chinese wages, Germany going to build factories to make Mercedes in Greece? Suppose no, because if they do so, they will condemn German workers to massive layoffs. So one should perhaps the Eurozone or the European Union as a whole might consider measures regarding goods coming from China or India, countries like this, if they have to somehow put some barriers there. Otherwise, the Eurozone is already in dire strait, is in a very difficult position. They cannot compete in the long run. And even if they have an advantage right now, that is Germany is exporting high-tech material to China, for how many years is going this to happen? I mean, Chinese can copy, Chinese can develop their own technology, and they have all margin to import in the European Union high-tech exports as well. And this is what they are trying to do. Practically, the Chinese are trying to have seized Greece and Portugal as their ports of entry. Now, these are in the periphery. What they are after is the Greek and Portuguese railroads, so they can push their exports in Germany, and then they'll have better and better cars to compete with German cars, better and better equipment to compete with the German equipment at a fraction of the cost, and with a margin of profit that makes German industrialists very nervous. So it's not the fault of lazy Greeks or lazy Southerners. The eyes do not fit in the pattern, but they are quite often considered to be Southerners. It's a problem of structure that either you fix it or you fail. And this is the European leaders cannot realize this simply because they are practicing small town politics.
Any other questions? I'd like to take this opportunity to thank the Consul General for once again coming to us and for presenting to us such an important topic. We've learned a lot from you this afternoon, and I'm sure we'll have an opportunity to discuss these ideas in class and in other places. So can you please join with me in applauding the Consul General? But our students, many of them will be leaving. And we would like to invite all of you to return because we will have speakers from various other countries coming to campus. And for now, we'd like to invite you to have some refreshments with us in the lounge.